Seenu, Hariprasad. He's Associate Professor and Director of Clinical Research at the University of Chicago. And we are looking forward for his talk on the role of ultra-widefield imaging in diabetic retinopathy and macular edema.
Thank you, Sebastian, and a wonderful presentation, Vas and Kwan. And I'm very humbled to follow these two wonderful lectures, and welcome to this symposium. So as Sebastian mentioned, I'll be giving a presentation on the role of ultra-wide-field imaging in diabetic retinopathy and macular edema. These are my disclosures. I am a consultant for Optos. Diabetes is a worldwide epidemic. It's expected to grow by 50% worldwide by the year 2025, and the Asia-Pacific is very much involved in this. Incidence of DME is 30% in patients who have had diabetes for more than 20 years, and undoubtedly, as the previous speaker said, the integration of ultra-wide-field imaging into our clinical practice has enhanced our ability to visualize the retinal periphery. Keep in mind that conventional fluorescein angiography only allows visualization of 45 to 60 degrees of the retina to be visualized per image. So why should we incorporate ultra-wide-field imaging into our practices? First of all, it provides new insights regarding the role of peripheral pathology in retinal diseases, but it also helps us identify disease that assists in clinical decision-making and treatment. It also quantifies ischemia, which is critical in this disease, and also it's very convenient to the patient and the photographer. So let's talk about documentation. It always amazes me how much of the retina periphery goes unimaged with traditional seven standard field imaging. And you can see that a vast, broad area of retina is unimaged with traditional photography. And to be able to simultaneously image this retina is critical, especially in diseases like diabetic retinopathy and diabetic macular edema. But what's most intriguing is when one does a fluorescein angiography, you can simultaneously image different areas of the retina. So as a photographer traditionally is imaging one area of the retina looking at neovascularization, he may be missing another area of the retina that has pathology as the fluorescein transits through the eye, and I'll be showing a case that demonstrates this very nicely. Here's a patient with a very severe proliferative diabetic retinopathy, and you can see how traditional imaging would have underestimated the vast peripheral non-perfusion that this patient has. So it gives us very good insights that the retinal periphery may be very much contributing to the pathology of the eye. There clearly is a clinical impact with the use of ultra-wide-field imaging and a wealth of research that's developing as well. Dr. Kish in the audience here, who will be giving the next lecture, he described how compared with conventional seven standard field imaging, ultra-wide-field fluorescein angiography reveals significantly more vascular pathology in patients with diabetic retinopathy, and improved retinal visualization may alter the classification of patients with this disease, and this influences treatment decisions. Lloyd-Paul Aiello and team show that non-midriatic Optos images have excellent agreement with dilated ETDRS photos and dilated fundus examination in determining severity of diabetic retinopathy and diabetic macular edema. And once again, you'll hear the theme throughout this talk that the classification of the disease is pivotal, not only from a research standpoint, but how to manage the patient. Wessel and colleagues, also associated with Dr. Kish, showed that peripheral retina ischemia is significantly correlated with diabetic macular edema in treatment-naive patients with diabetic retinopathy utilizing Optos 200TX ultra-wide-field imaging. So with this wealth of evidence that's developing about the retinal periphery possibly affecting the macula, does it make sense to do targeted pan-retinal photocoagulation now that we have the technology available to guide our treatment? So you look at targeting, it's been described that targeting PRP laser to ischemic retina may decrease ischemic drive, cytokine release, and ultimately reduce retinal vascular leakage and diabetic macular edema. So it's possible that using TRP to ablate peripheral areas of non-perfusion in combination with anti-VEGF may enhance the ability to alleviate diabetic macular edema by suppressing the permeability of the vasculature and decrease treatment burden from these injections, especially in a disease where the rate of bilaterality may be as high as 60%. So a study by Stanga and colleagues showed that the effects of targeted retinal photocoagulation on PDR showed some level of regression in 76% of patients as early as 12 weeks and complete disease regression by 12 weeks in 37% of patients and 33% of patients at 24 weeks. We also have done our own research looking at the impact of peripheral non-perfusion on recalcitrant diabetic macular edema. clearly there's a wealth of literature that's developing that shows that peripheral non-perfusion is a contributing factor in diabetic macular edema. These patients do have peripheral non-perfusion, capillary dropout, and this is affecting diabetic macular edema. So we hypothesize that the traditionally known variables that cause diabetic macular edema, such as pathologic permeability, high VEGF levels, localized ischemia, even mechanical traction, all these are modulated by varying degrees of peripheral non-perfusion. And this causes the clinical appearance of focal versus diffuse diabetic macular edema and even recalcitrant diabetic macular edema, how these variables all come together for the clinical picture that we see. So in patients who fail to respond to numerous focal grid lasers, intravitreal anti-VEGF injections, are we failing to recognize that the pathology in the periphery that exists is not being addressed with our conventional thinking in the treatment of diabetic macular edema? And given the availability of new technologies such as ultra-widefield fluorescein angiography, we need to investigate this in greater detail. And undoubtedly, our conventional therapies transiently decrease recalcitrant DME, but rarely provide enduring treatment. We published our results in the American Journal of Ophthalmology last year, and the purpose of this study was to explore the association of angiographic peripheral non-perfusion in focal and diffuse recalcitrant diabetic macular edema in patients with diabetic retinopathy. It was a retrospective study of 148 eyes in 76 patients who have been diagnosed with diabetic macular edema recalcitrant to focal laser or intravitreal injections for at least 2 years. So recalcitrant disease for 2 years. And we obtained Optos ultra-widefield fluorescein angiogram images, spectral domain OCTs, and we looked at the ultra-widefield fluorescein angiogram images and graded it for image quality as well as quantity of non-perfusion using ischemic index, which has been previously described by Steve Schwartz at UCLA. Mm-hmm. And we broke these patients up into four different groups. Cohort 1 had subjects who were diagnosed with mild NPDR and with recalcitrant diabetic macular edema. Group 2 had moderate or severe NPDR with recalcitrant DME. Group 3 had subjects with quiescent proliferative diabetic retinopathy with or without previous panretinal photocoagulation. And lastly, cohort 4 had active proliferative diabetic retinopathy with or without a previous laser. And this is how we calculate the ischemic index. You can see that this patient has an ischemic index of 59% when we demarcate the area of perfusion and the total area of the image. I'd like to show this image because this is a one of several examples in our study of misclassification of the patient into the wrong cohort based on clinical examination. When I examined this patient, it looked like a patient with quiescent proliferative diabetic retinopathy. And so we put this patient into cohort 3, now with quiescent disease. But when we did the Optos imaging, we realized there were 3 foci of active neovascular fronds as well as marked capillary dropout in the periphery. So this patient was converted to cohort 4 based on the imaging. So this is a very important finding. Dr. Kitchens, one of my close friends and colleagues, he says up to 12% of patients are misdiagnosed or wrongly categorized based on conventional imaging and our examinations. And this is a patient who has recalcitrant diabetic macular edema for 2 years. Our results were as follows. This bar graph is showing that the ischemic index in the 4 respective cohorts, when we examine these patients, we find a direct correlation between the ISI ischemic index and in eyes with increasing severity of diabetic retinopathy. So a clear direct correlation depending on the cohort the patient is in and the severity of diabetic retinopathy. You can also see in this bar graph that the mean number of focal laser treatments in the 4 respective cohorts are the same direct correlation, that the worse stage the patient has, the more number of laser treatments that were necessary over the course of 2 years. In our study, we found focal versus diffuse diabetic macular edema 41 versus 59%, and the mean ISI in the focal group was 41%. However, the mean ISI in the diffuse group was 64%. So undoubtedly, with worsening grade of diabetic macular edema, the ischemic index in the periphery is worse. So our group and others in the literature, mounting evidence, are showing that there's a clear proof of concept regarding the relationship of peripheral non-perfusion and macular edema based on work from various centers. Diabetic macular edema eyes with larger areas of retinal non-perfusion and greater severity of diabetic retinopathy were found to have the most recalcitrant diabetic macular edema based on two variables. Number one, the need for more focal grid laser treatments and less reduction on OCT over the two-year period compared to eyes with less peripheral non-perfusion. And it's very clear that a better understanding of the relationship between peripheral non-perfusion and recalcitrant diabetic macular edema will allow our current therapies to be more effective and more durable. I want to present just one very quick case to demonstrate the value of ultra-widefield imaging in our clinical practice. This is a 61-year-old African-American female, has type 2 diabetes, hypertension, hypothyroidism, and arthritis. A history of proliferative diabetic retinopathy with macular edema on both eyes, and she's had focal lasers, PRP lasers in the past, and her vision was quite good. And you can see that when I examined the patient in the clinic, we just saw one small area of active neovascularization along the inferotemporal arcade. But when we did wide-field imaging, this patient had four quadrants of neovascularization. And you can imagine when these patients undergo conventional standard field fluorescein angiography, as a photographer is imaging this area, the fluorescein may pass in and out of this area, and we may not even be able to image this. So the ability to simultaneously image the 200 degrees of the back of the eye can be very beneficial. So lastly, being able to better image the periphery will likely supply important information in the management of diabetic eye diseases, and better diagnosis may result in changes in disease classification from quiescent to PDR and really help guide treatment and ultimately help our patients. And from a research standpoint, ultra-widefield fluorescein angiography is providing us with a better understanding of disease mechanisms, and we're really understanding the relationship of peripheral ischemia and macular edema. Thank you so much for your attention.